Hello and welcome to FSM Television Network. Thank you for joining us this evening. I'm glad that you're here with us this evening, and I trust that you're here to help us to accomplish the show's two objectives. First, to glorify our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and secondly, to encourage all of us in the Lord. We're living in the last days of this earth history. Based upon the evidence of Scripture, it is clear that we're living in the last days of this earth history. And so there are many things that are happening, and the things that are happening, they're happening fast. The servant of the Lord made clear that in these days, things are going to happen, and when they happen, they're going to happen rapidly. And clearly, this is a time that we're living in. This is the season that we're living in. But we have nothing to fear. We have nothing to fear, because we saw clearly, as it is written, hundreds of years ago, in fact, thousands of years ago, it's written in Joshua, in Joshua chapter 1. In Joshua chapter 1, verse 1 through 9, Jesus, our God, commanded Joshua to be courageous and to be strong. And so we, living in these last days, we are commanded by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to be courageous and strong. Because our God is with us, we have nothing to fear. So again, I want to welcome us all to FSM Daily Digital Show. If you're here on the Zoom platform, or Facebook, or Twitter, or TCV FM Christian Radio, if you listen to us on the continent of Africa, Australia, Europe, North or South America, we just want to welcome us all to this show this evening. We do have as over 100 guests, my friend and my colleague in ministry, Dr. Laurencin. So we're looking forward to hear for him to continue the parallelism between the book of Revelation and the other books of the Bible. Looking forward to hear a word from him this evening. I shared with you last night that we were scheduled to launch on various platforms today. We have some interruption in respect to the provider where they run into some difficulties. So as such, it is postponed temporarily until tomorrow. So tomorrow we will be here live on all these various platforms that I will now share with you. First would Chromecast. We then Chromecast. Secondly, Google Play. Thirdly, Windows. Fourth, we have will be an Android TV. Fifth would be on Roku TV, sixth would be on Fire TV, seventh will be on Apple TV, eight will be on Chugo TV, nine will be on Glory Star satellites. And all these various platforms will be able to broadcast in 131 nations of the world. And so far, we are now broadcasting on Chugod TV. Tomorrow we will also going to be broadcast on Glory Star satellite, which is going to be channel number 33, both in the United States and Canada. In fact, in all of North America, we'll be on channel 33. We'll be on the same platform as CNN, etc. And so you're going to have various ways to watch us on a daily basis. But we had some technical difficulties, and as such, we have to postpone some of these platforms until tomorrow. The only one which is broadcasting now is Chugo TV, Chugo TV, and that I will give you more information. But if you have Chugo TV, the channel on Chugo TV is 205. But as time goes on, we will share with you more detail in the next 24 hours or so, when all these platforms will be live and you can watch them from the comfort, when you can watch the show from the comfort of your very home, your living room. You can watch them, and as we grow together in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I just want to make one observation. Going through the various recordings and getting things together, I run into so many videos, so many shows with my late friend, our late friend, Dr. Payne. And this is going to be one of the hardest moments. He was a visionary. He saw this coming, and it's going to be so difficult to even go forward knowing that our friend is not with us, my friend and my brother. You know, the Bible says a friend is closer than a brother. And this, that man of God was a true friend. And it was so emotional today as I go through some of the various shows as we in the process of preparing to share this gospel with the various nations of the world. But coming tomorrow, we will have a special show for you. We'll be live, and it would be on all of these various platforms that I have just shared with you. Well, with that being said, help me now to welcome our 100 guests in a few moments. But first, before we do so, let's offer a word of prayer that God will continue to lead us going forward, and also that we have a special song, and then we will hear from our 100 guests, my friend, should I say, our friend on this network, Dr. Laurencin, and my pastoral colleague. With that being said, please bow your head with me as I ask God, the Holy Spirit, to direct us going forward. Good God of heaven and earth, as I navigate and do so many different things to launch this network. In fact, it's already been launched on one platform. But Father, as we go through the process, I am reminded how fragile we all are. Oh, we all are fragile. The Bible made it clear that we are allotted 70 and 10. And sometimes God bless us to see more than 70 and 10. But Father, if we live 73 years old, or if we live 100 years old, or if we live almost 900 years old, like some of the people in the Bible, The fact of the matter is sin impacts us all. We all are impacted by sin negatively. Oh, Father, we long for the day when the sky will roll back like a scroll. And you will come, oh God, to remove us from this sin-cursed world. But until then, oh God, you've called us to share the everlasting gospel with the entire world. So, Father, as we set out to accomplish this great task, an awesome task, we know that we need you. So, as such, we surrender to you now. And we ask, you know, God, that you will continue to direct us forward collectively to accomplish the single goal, which is to share you with the entire world. Be with all of us now, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. At this time, we're going to call up for special music from Ella Marcel, and then we'll hear from our 100 guests, my friend and my colleague, Dr. Laurencin.
When I think of how he came so far from glory, came to dwell among the lowly such as I, to suffer shame and such disgrace, on Mount Calvary take my place. And I ask myself the question, who am I? Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine, Lord? Answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so. And to an old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I? I'm reminded of his words, I'll leave you never. If you be true, I'll give to you life forever. I wonder what I could have done to deserve God's only son. Fight my battles until they're won, for who am I? Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine, Lord? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so. But to an old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I? To an old rugged cross he go, for who am I?
Take it away, Pastor.
Praise be to God. Thank you so much, evangelist and minister Marcel, for blessing us with this wonderful song, reminding us that Jesus Christ is the reason, the purpose, the essence for our existence. And therefore, who am I? We are nothing except for Jesus Christ, who have made us his jewels. He have made us heir of the kingdom of God. So we want to thank you, Pastor Barnaby, for your due diligence, for your infatigable labor in the gospel ministry, working so hard to see that the good news of salvation be proclaimed and broadcast throughout the entire world. This is the commission that Christ has given us. He commissioned us to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Every nation, kindred, tongue, and people need to hear the good news of salvation. And I feel very honored and humble at the same time to be your guest this evening as we share the word of God together. Thank you once again, Brother Evangelist Marcel, for blessing us. Thanks for all the other participants and supporters, the sponsors, and for all those who have been faithful and supportive to Pastor Barnaby, his wife, and family. Let us pray once again. We're going to ask God to bless us as we proceed with the word for this evening. Heavenly Father, we pause in your presence just a little while longer, asking for divine wisdom. Give us the insight. Unlock what seemed to be mysterious to our human understanding, and make it plain, according to the prophet Habakkuk, that he may run that readeth it. For the vision is for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. For we know your word, O Father, will triumph gloriously, And the prophet Amos says that righteousness shall cover the earth as the water covered the ocean. So bless every listener, bless everyone who is going through trying times, times that is truly morally, socially, and spiritually excruciating, where every fiber of our being is being tested and tried. But through your divine promise, we will, by your grace, triumph gloriously. And so we pray for this blessing and for healing under the unction of the Holy Spirit to be upon everyone tonight, this evening. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So my brothers and sisters, we will continue from where we left off last week. And this evening, I will continue to share with you what God has impressed upon my heart. And we're going to look at the book of Ezra and Nehemiah, and then we will continue from there from the Old Testament, and we will move on to look at how those prophetic revelations written in those books are being fulfilled in the last book of the Bible, the book of Revelation. For those who are joining for the first time, for those who have not been privy to the previous presentations, let me say to you that this exercise is designed to reinvigorate and reignite faith in the Word of God. You see, my dear friends, the book of Revelation summarizes the entire Old Testament. In fact, it also does the same to the New Testament. But since we began with the Old Testament, let me say that every book in the Old Testament has a direct fulfillment in the New Testament. And in particular, the book of Revelation summarizes all, put everything into perspective. The perspective of which tells us that the Word of God is authentic, it is authoritative, it is reliable, it is trustworthy. There is no other book in the entire world that can meet such a test. But the Bible stands on its own merit. The Bible is its best own interpreter. The internal evidence contained in the book of the book of Revelation points us back to the promises made by God in each of the Old Testament books. So as we examine and as we looked at some of the key parts of the Old Testament books, because of time, we wouldn't be able to unravel and go to each one of them methodically, but we're going to go through them selectively. In other words, we will be looking at the themes, the key themes of each of the books. The themes speak of a grand subject, the subject of salvation. God's plan for the salvation of humanity is written in the Old Testament type or typology and is being fulfilled in the New Testament symbols or symbological application. So there, when we look at the types and the symbols and we bring them together, have them to interface by looking at them through the lens of parallelism. We look at the parallel. On the one hand, we have the Old Testament. On the other hand, we have the New Testament. But then we are looking at specific books. And the specific book we're going to begin with is the book of Ezra and Nehemiah, and then Revelation in the New Testament. So when we look at the book of Ezra, most people who perhaps have read or taken a glance at the book of Ezra simply overlook some of the historical accounts, the events that took place that was chronicled or written by Ezra, the scribe. Ezra, who was one of the selected, he was a priest, and he was selected to chronicle or to write the events pertaining to the repatriation of the children of Israel from captivity in Babylon back to Jerusalem. So it was a movement of God's people from Babylon, and they were there because of Nebuchadnezzar, who had taken them captive for a period of time. But according to the promises of God, they will not stay there forever, but there will be a time of repatriation, that they would leave Babylon and go back or return to Jerusalem. Why? They would have to go back to Jerusalem to worship God, to honor God, to give glory and praise to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But the problem with repatriation or returning back to Jerusalem was that the city and the temple of Jerusalem had been destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar and his army. So in order for the repatriation to be effective, to be for the repatriation to gain momentum and for it to be established in full force, the rebuilding and the reconstruction of the temple had to precede the repatriation. In other words, until the temple was rebuilt, repatriation was considered unsuccessful. So you cannot go back to the temple and worship if the temple is in ruin. It doesn't make sense. So for the temple to, for the people to go back and to give praises to God, the temple had to be rebuilt, because you would not go back to a church to praise God if the church is in a state of ruin or a state of disrepair. So the priest Ezra had to chronicle the events leading to the reconstruction of the temple. And one of the key elements of the reconstruction of the temple was that the priest had to be reinstated, or the priesthood had to begin to function as they used to prior to the destruction of the temple. So in chapter 3, and remember, we are looking at the key elements in the book. The key element in the book of Ezra that stands out is, number one, the reinstatement and the reorganization, refunctionality of the duties of the priest. So in chapter 3, verses 1 to 13, we have accounts of the priest being reinstated. For example, in verse 8, when the language of the second year unto the house of God at Jerusalem in the second month began, Zerubbabel was the priest. And also talks about the remnant of the brethren, the remaining ones of the priest and the Levites and all that were came out of captivity unto Jerusalem. So they evidently, not all who went to Babylon in exile returned, but those who returned, they were constituted and referred to, of course, as the remnant. And then we find in verse 10, verse 10 says, and when the builders laid the foundation of the temple, of the Lord, they set the priest in their appointed, in the apparel with trumpets, and the Levites and the sons of Asaph with cymbals to praise the Lord after the ordinance of David, king of Israel. So the priest were re-robed in the regalia, in the fine priestly regalia, the priestly attire, and then they were given trumpets. That was one of the signal elements of the worship services during the time of David. The temple choir consists of the priest. They sang for joy. They give glory to God. And so when the foundation was laid for the building and the construction of the temple, the priest took their trumpets, they dressed in the regalia, and they sang for joy. They give God thanks and praise. And verse 11 says, and they sang together because in praising and giving thanks unto the Lord, because he is good, for his mercy endureth forever toward Israel. And all the people shouted with a great shout when they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. I say hallelujah to this. So you could imagine how joyful, how excited the people were, because they were in captivity, and the temple had been laid in ruin for almost 70 years. There was no services going on. And verse 12 says, and many of the priests and Levites and the chief of the fathers, who were ancient men, they when they saw the foundation of the house was laid before their eyes, wept with a loud voice, and many shouted aloud for joy. Especially those who had seen and experienced the worship services in the temple prior to the destruction, prior to the captivity. They were able to witness the reestablishment and the rebuilding of the temple. So they were ecstatically filled with joy, and they were shouted for joy. They cried for joy. Wonderful. Now, when you read this story in the book of Ezra, and you ask yourself the question, what is the significance of this to us today? How does this play out? How does our religious experience could parallel that of the ancient Hebrew people when they left captivity in Babylon and they experienced the reconstruction of the temple in Jerusalem? Well, let us turn to the book of Revelation. Let us see what Revelation has to say in connection to the experience the children of Israel had during the time of Ezra for the reconstruction of the temple. Let us turn to chapter 1, verse 6 of Revelation. First Revelation chapter 1, verse 6. Chapter 1, verse 6 of Revelation. Verse 6 says, and have made us, because John, who wrote Revelation, he is speaking of the experience of the last day church, of the last day people of God. And he is telling us in verse 6, and have made us, who have made us? God, Jesus Christ, have made us priest unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. You notice the language? You notice the theme? The theme of rejoicing and giving thanks to God. Why? Because he have made us priest. When we read Ezra, the people of Israel were rejoicing because the priest took the trumpets and they were singing. The priests were giving, once again, the opportunity to perform the services and to minister. God is going to use us in a figurative, symbolic sense to minister unto him. He will make us priests unto himself. So we see the theme there. Let us turn to chapter 5. Let us enter chapter 5 of Revelation, chapter 5. And we will read further, given more details of the functionality of God's people in the last days. Chapter 5, from verse 9 through 10. Revelation says, "And they sang a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seal thereof, the seals thereof, for thou was slain from, and thou hast redeemed us to God by the blood, by thy blood, out of every kindred, tongue, and people, and nation." Verse 10. "And has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth." So there we see the theme of priest being repeated by John in Revelation, pointing to the work of God's last day people. God is going to use his people to function in a priestly capacity. Now, let us go back and look at the experience that the children of Israel had. They were in captivity. They were held against their will. They were under the rulership of a foreign nation. They were subjected to all the evil and the environment that was conducive to false worship, idol worship. You remember when the children of Israel, when Nebuchadnezzar rather, had this great image constructed in the plain of Jura, and at the sound of the trumpet and the cornet and the harp and all the musical instrument, commanded that every knee should bow and worship that golden image that he had set up. But we have the record that God had faithful followers who would not bow down. Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego were among them. And as a result of their faithfulness, God delivered them. Today, we are exposed to the sins of modern day Babylon. We are, in a figurative sense, we are literally in captivity, because this world is not our home. And we are facing a sinful environment, an environment that is laced with idolatry. There are false gods, false idols that are erect in every domain, in every country, in every territory. And wherever we go, we have false systems of worship that are demanding for us to bow to them, to serve them, and to worship them. But thank God, he would have faithful servants, faithful soul followers, who will not yield nor bow to the modern day images that the devil is using through modern technology and through the political and economic systems of the world, to have people to turn their back on the true God, the God of creation, and to worship the false gods of this earth. God will have his chosen people faithful to him that will not bow down to modern day idols and modern day false worship. So now we are experiencing what the children of Israel did experience during the time of their captivity. But there will be a repatriation. Jesus Christ is going to take us out from this world, and we will be traveling to a different Jerusalem. That Jerusalem is the new Jerusalem, and that new Jerusalem is where we will function as priests unto God and unto Jesus Christ. Isn't this wonderful? So the language motif, the language, and the theme of the priest functionality, the temple reconstruction, is going to be replayed in the figurative symbolic sense when God's people are redeemed from earthly captivity, the captivity of sin, and we will be reinstated forever to reign with Christ, and we shall be priests unto God forever and ever. Amen. So now we're going to turn to the book of Nehemiah, a wonderful little book, Nehemiah. Nehemiah lived during the same period, the same epoch, the same era, time of the repatriation to Israel. And under Nehemiah the prophet, we are told that not under Ezra, the priests were reinstated, but under Nehemiah, the walls and the gates were being repaired. So the gates, now when we turn to Nehemiah chapter 3 verses 1 to 32, we find something very, very dramatic, very interesting, eye-opening about the activity of the children of Israel. In chapter 3, which is highlighted there on the screen, from verses 1 to 32, I wouldn't have the time to read every verse, but I'm just going to just zero in on some of the key names and terms that are highlighted, mentioned in that particular chapter. When we looked at chapter 3, verse 1b, part B, or the latter part of verse 1 in chapter 3, we have there that the priest rose up with the brethren and the priest, and they builded the sheep gate and sanctified it. They builded the sheep gate and sanctified it. Now, there were several gates around Jerusalem, particularly the temple. And each of those gates had a name. And the sheep gate, we find allusions to the sheep gate even during the time of Christ's ministry. He talked about the sheep gate during the time of his ministry in the Synoptic Gospels. Now, also, not only the sheep gate is mentioned by Nehemiah the prophet, but we find in verse 3, there was the fish gate. The sheep gate in verse 1, in verse 3, the fish gate is mentioned. And then in verse 15, we also have the gate of the fountain mentioned, which means that there were water that was available at that particular gate, symbolically represents the washing, ritual washing. Before one enters into that gate, they had to wash, go through the ritual washing. You remember the disciples were accused for eating with unwashed hands. Well, they were the fountain gate, there was water available so that folk will wash ritualistically before they eat or partake of any of the ceremonies. Very interesting. And then Jesus talked about in one of his parables or stories, he talked about how it is easier for a camel to enter a needle's eye, the eye of a needle, than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. The camel had to stoop, the animal, the camel had to stoop with the load. They would not offload the burden on the camel's back. So the camel had to stoop and then crawl through the gate. And it was very tasking. It was a very serious undertaking for an animal. So what they had to do is, if you want the animal to enter through the gate easily, you had to take off the burden, take the burden off its back. Once you take the burden, the load that it was carrying off its back, then the camel will be able to enter. So when Jesus says, it is easier for a camel to enter through the eye of the needle, that's the name of the gate, than the rich man to enter heaven. For a rich man to enter heaven, he had to take off the burden that he is carrying. And what is the burden or the load that the rich man is carrying? The money that he has, the wealth that he has. So the wealth, if he hold on to the wealth, it will be difficult for that rich man to enter heaven. So he had to offload it. And Christ used the analogy of the camel with the burden that he carries to bring the message across. So it is very interesting when we read the accounts of the Old Testament, then we see the language. And we, in verse 28 of chapter 3, we hear about the horse gate, the horse gate. We hear about verse 32. Another gate is mentioned, verse 32. And so as you read the chapters, you see the different gates are mentioned. Now, the key point here is the theme. That's what we must pay attention to, the theme. Now, where do we find the theme of the different gates in the old temple in Jerusalem mentioned in the New Testament, particularly the book of Revelation? Where do we find that? It's there, but we have to find it. In Revelation chapter 21, verses 10 through 21, there is a new city called the New Jerusalem. And that new city, the New Jerusalem, has walls and gates. Walls and gates. Just as the walls and the gates had to be repaired in the book of Nehemiah, in Revelation, the theme of walls and gates are mentioned. But they are not going to be repaired. They have already been built. So Revelation chapter 21, when we turn to the last book in the Bible, the New Testament, and we read about that new city, it will have a deep impression on our faith in God, knowing that what was prescribed and what was reality in the Old Testament has a symbolic fulfillment in the New Testament. So our faith in God, my dear friends, will be deepened, broadened, and strengthened when we look at the inspiration, the reliability, and the authenticity of the Word of God. Chapter 21 of Revelation, reading from verse 10. John says, and he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain and showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, and her light was like unto a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal. Verse 12, and had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and the names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. 12 gates, names are mentioned. The gates are named, just like the gates were named in the time of Ezra. The gates were named. And the gates of the New Jerusalem are named. The walls were repaired in the book of Ezra. The walls has already been built in Revelation, the New Jerusalem. Praise God. So we see the parallel. We see the connection when we bring the books of the Old Testament face to face with the book of Revelation, the last book in the biblical canon, that brings closure, that brings the conclusion. We have the prelude, we have the introduction, and now we have the conclusion. What do we do with the Word of God when we see such unique blending, such unique connection? It tells us, my friends, that the Word of God is truly inspired. We could trust and believe in the Word of God. This is the message for you today as you listen. But there's more to come. When we look at the book of Esther and Job, there are also some profound lessons to be had. The lessons are intended for us to be wise unto salvation, that when we go through our modern experiences, we look back at what the ancient Israelites went through. Those particular characters are highlighted. Esther was a young lady, a young Jewish woman who was led, who was held in captivity by the Persian Empire. And during the time of the Persian Empire, which succeeded by the Grecian Empire, the influences of the kings who ruled at the time took control and had precedence over the worship services of the ancient children of Israel. But in spite of the concealment of some of them of their identity and the blending that went on through intermarriage, when a particular decree was issued for the destruction of the Jews through malice, hatred, and jealousy, as well as racism, which is something that is akin to what's happening today, the faithful people of God stood out. And one of the faithful people was this young woman by the name of Esther. She, because of her gracefulness, because of her charm, because of her talent, because of her beauty, she was given a special position as a beauty pageant to be the wife of a king, and therefore she would be coronated as queen. So in that particular book, the book of Esther, the book that carried the name of this particular young lady, she, the queen of that realm, she had a bridal procession. She had to go through a purification process. And in chapter 2 of the book of Esther, from verses 1 through 8, there are certain themes that are outstanding, that stands out. And when we read about the procession, and we'll read about the vindication and the purification that took place, it has a ring of future fulfillment to God's people. God's people in scripture, in the Bible, is referred to as the bride of Christ, the bride of Christ. And the role that Queen Esther played reflect the role that we as God's last day people have to play in preparation for Christ's second coming. There was a purification. There was a cleansing. That tells us that we as a church have to go through a purification process in order to meet the bridegroom. We as a church, we are the bride. The church is the bridegroom. But before the marriage takes place, there must be a purification. And in chapter 2, verses 1 through 8, the elaborate process of the purification occurred, took place, and the prophet talked about it in great detail. But because of time, we wouldn't be able to go into all of it. I'm just highlighting it to you. But let's look at Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19 also talked about the bridal ceremony of the church that will become eventually become the bride of Christ. You remember the parable of the 10 virgins that Christ gave? He talked about 5 wise and 5 foolish young girls. And the moral of that story is that the church ought to be ready. And the preparation hinges on having extra oil in our lamps. The oil represents the Holy Spirit, and the light or the fire represent the Word of God. So in order to be ready for Christ's second coming as the bride of Christ, we must be filled with, our vessels must be filled with oil, which represents the Holy Spirit, so that we would give light, and our light is the Word of God. David said in Psalm 119:105, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." Without the Word of God and without the Holy Spirit, we will not be able to give light, and therefore not be ready to welcome and receive the bridegroom when he comes back the second time, which is Jesus Christ. So when we look at the Old Testament and we do this study and we juxtapose, bring in parallel the type and the antitype, the figurative and the symbolic, we are able to understand our role as followers of Christ and how we ought to play the role of fulfilling the Bible prophecies. Chapter 19 of Revelation, verses 7 through 9. Revelation 19, 7 through 9 says, "Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb, which is Jesus Christ, is come. For the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife have made herself ready. Unto her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints." For she ought to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. That's the purification. The purification now means that after we go through this process of cleansing, we will be made white. In other words, we cannot be ready for Christ's second coming, for this marriage, if our garments, our character, is not cleansed. Let us go back to the parable Christ gave, another parable he gave actually, about the invitation to a wedding. He says that after the invitation was given, the king made special arrangement that the guest to the wedding should be given a special attire, special outfit. But to this man who was given the outfit, he decided not to put it on. So when the king came and saw everybody was dressed in the chosen apparel, the chosen garment, except for this man, the king asked, "Sir, why haven't you on the wedding garment?" He was speechless because he had it and chose not to put it on. So now the Bible says that he was taken out of the wedding and thrown out into outer darkness, and there was weeping and gnashing of teeth. That tells us, my friend, that if we do not have the righteousness of Jesus Christ, if our character are not being purified, we will be cast out of the kingdom of God, and there will be gnashing of teeth. There will be regret, there will be crying, there will be gnashing of teeth, because we will be in a state of we will be placed in outer darkness. And so therefore, that's not a place or condition that anyone wants to be in. When we look at the book of Job, the book of Job presents a unique experience. We remember in chapter 1, verses 7 and 8, Satan, the adversary, present himself before God. And there was the inquiry about Job, the servant of God. And Satan had the audacity to say to God that the reason why Job was faithful and loyal, it is because God had placed a hedge around him. In other words, what he was saying to God was, the reason why some people would honor you and worship you, it is because you have blessed them and give them favor. So if you take away your blessings, if you take away your protection, they will curse you to your face. But God, who knew who Job was, who knew his heart, his loyalty was not based upon the superficial and the artificial. Job was not a token worshiper like some people are today. They go to church because and they render their worship like tokenism. They render their worship because they have something to boast about. Oh, well, God did this for me. God did that for me. Therefore, I'm serving him. How about if you did not have those things? Would you still serve God? You see, today you hear about prosperity preachers talking about if you sow the seed of $100, of $1,000, you're going to get X, Y, Z blessings. Suppose you give $1,000, $500, and you did not get what you expected to get from God. Would you still continue to honor God and to worship him? You see, some people misunderstand God. They use God as someone using an ATM machine or a microwave. You punch the button and lo, what you want comes out. But God is not like that, my friends. God cannot be manipulated. God cannot be used as a disposable item. We have to respect God, honor God, and treat God with the utmost respect that he deserves. And so therefore, in the lesson of Job, we find that Satan had a miscalculation and he wanted to have Job to diminish his devotion and to serve God out of mere tokenism. But then Job stood faithful to God. Job decided that he will not give in. He will not be succumbed to all the devices and the temptations. He lose everything he had, but yet still his fidelity was unwavering. And so as a result of Job's faithfulness to God, we need to ask ourselves the question. Before Christ comes at the second coming, will there be Job-like people? Will there be people like Job who will stand up for truth and for righteousness, even if it means that they have lost everything? They lose their job. They lose their income. They lose their family because they stood faithful to God. Today, there are many people, my dear friends, that have been tested. They were unable to get jobs because they will not work on the Sabbath. They would not eat certain foods. They would not go certain places. They would not associate themselves with people that are not honoring God and people who are involved in decadence and pleasure seeking and worldly amusements. They decided that they're going to be loyal to God. And as a result, they would lose their popularity. People would laugh at them. People will castigate them, malign them, and refuse to give them any kind of acceptance because of their position and because of their stand to God. So where do we find this in Revelation? In Revelation chapter 2, verses 8 through 11, Satan presents himself in a similar manner. And what Satan tried to do in Revelation, he accuses the last day churches. And all the churches that stood from Ephesus to Laodicea, Satan went after them relentlessly. He went after them, and sadly, some of the churches acquiesced and gave over to the devices and temptations of the devil. But there are churches that stood up representing individuals, representing characters that we refuse to bow down, just like Job refused to bow down. But let us look at one of the two, a few of the verses there. Because of time, we wouldn't be able to read all. But when we read, we will see the theme. Remember that keyword, theme? Yes, indeed. We will see the theme of the temptation of the adversary. And we will be able to connect the dots. In Revelation chapter 2, reading from verse 8. Verse 8 says, Revelation chapter 2, verse 8, "And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is to come. I know thy works and tribulation and poverty, but thou art rich. And I know the blasphemy of them which say they are Jews and are not, but are of the synagogue of Satan." These are people who chose to listen to Satan, to follow his wicked insinuations and devices, and who decided not to be loyal and faithful to God. So we find among the seven churches, Smyrna was one of those who did not follow God faithfully. But then now we have the other churches who stood faithful to God. Who stood faithful to God. Another one that disobeyed God was the church at verse 15 says, "So thou hast also them that hold the doctrines of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate." That's what the Lord says. "Repent is the message. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and I will fight against them which with the sword of my mouth. He that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. To him that overcometh, I will give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saveth he that receiveth." So the promises of God to the overcomers, to the faithful, to those who are loyal to God, is sure, is guaranteed. We must not listen to the devices of the devil, of the enemy, my friends. We must not follow after popularism, popular religion, the easy way out, the one that is pleasing, self-pleasing, does not cut it. We must make a decided effort. We must be determined to serve God at any cost. Serve him with all our hearts. Serve him sincerely. Serve him patiently. And God will give us a crown of life. Write our names on the book of life. Give us a new name, and that we will live and reign with him for eternity. When we looked at the other churches, each of the churches, there were some elements of faithfulness and some elements of disloyalty and unfaithfulness. Very important. In verse 26 says, "He that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations." Hallelujah to God. And again he says, verse 29, "He that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches." So all of the different messages that are given there to the churches from Ephesus to Laodicea is something that is of tremendous, tremendous importance. But let me go back to the first one, and then I'll conclude with the last one. The first church, the church of Ephesus, chapter 2, verse 1. Listen to the condition and the character of this particular church. "Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. I know thy works and thy labor, and thy patience, and that hold fast which thou hast, I'm sorry, And now knowest thou, and now thou canst not bear them which are evil, and thou hast tried them which say they are apostles and are not, and has found them liars. Verse 3, and has borne and has patience, and for my name's sake have labored and has not fainted. That's good commendation for the first church. But later on, through the ages, through the different epochs, for the different periods, something drastically happened. And so therefore, by the time the church comes to the very end, the last one, the church of Laodicea, the character was totally bad. It was bad. And so that tells us it is not how we start, how we began the Christian journey, is how we end it. We must end faithfully to God. There are a lot of people who will give up. They will backslide. They will turn away from God. But God has promised those who endure to the end, they shall be saved. And then we find in the last church, the church of Laodicea, chapter 3, verse 14, says, and unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write these things, saith the Amen, the faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. Listen to what God says, the diagnosis for the last church. Listen to what God says. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou be either cold or hot. Because thou art lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spew thee out of my mouth. What is the real condition? The real condition is that the church is lukewarm, my friends. Today, those who professed to be followers of God are not living up to heaven's expectation. There is a compromise. There is an appearance of godliness. But when it comes to obedience and following faithfully the will of God, the last day church finds herself being more loyal to the world, to worldly politics, worldly amusement, worldly fashion, all the worldly stuff, rather than being faithful to God. So because of time, I would have to stop here, but I must say to you that when you look at the language of each of the Old Testament books, from Genesis all the way to Malachi, and you picked out and you select and you look and you view at the different themes that are highlighted in each of the books, and then you parallel brings them to stand in parallel to the statements and the theme of Revelation, you can see a harmonious blend between the books of the Old Testament and the book of Revelation. May God bless you, my friends, as we go through this exercise, that your faith in God will be deepened, broadened, and therefore you will find yourself at peace with God, knowing that you cannot go wrong when you trust God and his word. May God bless you. And now I will turn over to Pastor Barnaby as he invites the rest of the platform viewers and guests to chime in on what has been presented this evening.
Thank you very much, Dr. Laurencin. Indeed, we appreciate that which you set before us. As you were presenting and making the parallelism between the various books and link it to Revelation, it called into my mind the common theme of the book, of all the books of the Bible, in particular as it is noted in Genesis, where we see in Genesis that when God created us with the intent for us to live for eternity, we fell into sin, and sin equal death, and God redeem us. Isn't this the same parallelism that's playing out, may it be in the story of Ezra, may it be in Revelation, may it be in the other books of the Bible? Isn't it the same story just being told in from a different perspective? For example, you see, let's look at the Ezra situation. They were reconstructing the wall because they turned away from God. And so a part of the reconstruction is the redemptive act of God trying to bring them back to himself. What says you? Does this still fall in line what you bring what you're sharing with us?
Yes, indeed. God is always about reconstructing, reconstituting, reinstating. When we return to God, God does not leave us in a state of disrepair. God does not leave us in a state of ruin. God brings us back to the point of originality. When we were before the fall, when we were before we backslided, we walk off the path of righteousness. Look at the lesson of the prodigal son. The Bible says when the prodigal son left his father, he went into riotous living and wasted all his substance. And then when he returned, guess what? The father reinstated him back to sonship, gave him a ring, put it on his finger, a robe, the best robe, and re-established him by giving him full authority. That's the way God does his work. You see, this is why there is hope for the backslider. There is hope for those who once walked with God and no longer walk with him today. There are some people who think, though, if they come back, they should take a back seat and they should never be part of the ministry where they used to function, where they used to sing and preach before they left. No. The Bible does not teach that. The Bible says when you come back to God, you ought to come back to where you were. If you were a singer, come back and start singing again. Come back, start preaching again. Come back, start worshiping God, giving him God and praise. Because God does not treat us as though we are still in the mess. No, God treat us like nothing had happened before. We can't hear you, Pastor Barnaby.
Thank you for that. So we see this now, the theme of the Bible then is God's redemptive act. God reaching out to redeem lost sinners because we have turned away from God. And so is it fair to say then, even when we're looking at prophecy, may it be Ezra, Jeremiah, Daniel, Revelation, etc., it is important for us to see it from the perspective of God trying to reinstate us, God trying to redeem us because we fell into sin and God is calling us back to himself.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Indeed, I truly appreciate it. With that being said, is there a statement or a question from someone in the audience? Do you have a statement? And does what have been discussed here, is it in line with your understanding of the Bible, our understanding of Scripture? Do you see things differently? Give us your school of thought, please. It may be in the form of a statement or a question. Anyone? Well, if there's no question, I want to continue in asking your question, then Pastor, as we're living now in the 21st century, we're living in, I do believe that we're living in the last days of this earth history. And so as we come now to Revelation, which unseal all the various prophecy that were once sealed, maybe in Revelation. And you point out to us, particularly in Revelation chapter 21, verse 10. In fact, I want to read it in our hearing, and then I want to pose a question. You mentioned that the Bible is made clear, Revelation chapter 21, verse 10. And he said, and he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and shewed me that great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, having the glory of God, and her light was the light unto the stone of most precious, even like unto jasper stone, clear as crystal, and had a wall great and high, and 12 gates, and the gates of 12 angels. I was impressed when he mentioned the gates of 12 angels. We know that angels represent messengers. What does that have to do in light of what Ezra and Joshua and the high priest were doing then versus the apostles in the New Testament church, what they were doing then, and us, our era, what we should be doing in respect to the proclamation of the gospel?
Because what happened with the experience is God turned it around, and what was done in typology had to be fulfilled symbolically in the New Testament.
When you said typology,
that was everything that happened, the work of the priest, the work of the temple, the offerings, and the different. Because you remember in Ezra, the timing of the feast, the seventh month, the 14th day of the month, all of those things had its fulfillment in the New Testament. Jesus Christ, everything points to Christ. Now, the only thing that is missing, Christ has already fulfilled all the types, all the typology. The only thing that is missing is for the people of God in the New Testament to be reinstated, the people of God in the Old Testament to join in with the people of God in the New Testament, and so bring everything in culmination. And so what Revelation is teaching us and telling us that there is going to be in a symbolic form, the priest work, we will be priests unto God, we will reign with him, we will be the bride of Christ, we will be the wife, we will be everything in symbolic form will be fulfilled in us. So that's what God is doing in scripture. Now, while the children of Israel were building the walls, and they were constructing the temple, and all the things were taking place, they thought that the literal building was going to stand forever. There's never going to be a destruction. Unfortunately, it got destroyed again. Were they wrong? No. Because the temple of God is pointed in Revelation where the walls will be permanently built, and never will there be any destruction. The people of God will forever be with him, and they will never go back into captivity. We will be priests unto God and forever. That's what Revelation says. So their dream of an eternal kingdom, an everlasting kingdom in typology, was not established on earth forever, but it will be established symbolically in the earth made new forever. Do you understand the connection now?
Yes, Barry. What I want for you, the reason why I pose the question is to simplify it for some in the audience that may not know the difference between type and type, as you were using those. Sometimes the esoteric terminology could be clear to us.
Difficult to understand. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but
I appreciate you asking the question for the purpose of breaking it down on the simplest terms. so that all of us could, because if the word of God is presented and we do not understand it, then there's no purpose for the preaching of the word. It has to be understood. It has to be understood.
Indeed, indeed. With that being said, is there a statement or a question, maybe something have been said that you're seeking further clarification, you may see differently? Where are you in your walk with God and your understanding of Scripture? Do you have a statement or a question? Going once, going twice. Well, if there's no question, here I am thinking here, where my school of thought is.
Okay, just before you answer, I think Sister Marva Motley wanted to ask a question.
Sure. Sister Motley, do you have a question for us?
I do.
Yes.
Go ahead, Sister Motley.
Okay. Can you unmute me?
Can you hear us? Sister Motley, we're not hearing you. I think she having some technical difficulties. In the next 60 seconds or so, Sister Motley, if your microphone, you could just interrupt me and I will let you pose the question. So please,
you could do, Pastor Barnaby, is to unmute her, because I think she's muted.
Okay.
I'm seeing her page right here, but she's muted. So you are the controller.
Okay.
You could unmute her.
Sister Motley, can you hear us now?
No, she is still muted.
All right, let's move on and we'll come back. If I heard that someone else may have a question, could you please pose a question, please?
Yes, greetings.
Greetings, Elder. How are you today?
Oh man, I made it. We made it. We are here by the help of God. We just lost a sister. Prominent at our church yesterday. Mm-hmm. She was responsible for handing out, food like apples and those type of vegetables and stuff. And we got sick for a moment with COVID and then heard that she passed. So in the midst of life, man, we are having it right, left and center.
Mm.
Anyway, my question is, now, we had the Israelites trapped in Egypt. They were promised to be taken to their own land. And we followed them. Of course, you mentioned the Ezra situation where some of them went back after the 70 years prophesied by Daniel. Hope you hear me clearly because my voice is not too well. Yes. So all over the Bible, she talks about the children of Israel returning to their own land. Ezekiel 37 said, the dry bones, they will be raised and taken to their land. Is it not unreasonable for Moses, he was taken, punished because of his deeds, not to enter the process. So you will see that God puts a whole lot of interest and importance to the people going back to their land. Now, that said, isn't it unreasonable for God to come for Israel, because you know their descendants are here still, that he would just take them to heaven, you know, at his second coming, and they don't. And that promise is not fulfilled. We think, I mean, he promised, but his promises never fail. So how do you break that down?
Pastor?
Well, that's a very good question, my senior elder, very good question. Unfortunately, not everyone who went to exile, who went into exile, returned when the Lord opened the door and made the way for them to return. They got so comfortable in the Babylonian homes, their lifestyle, the culture and the social aspect of living in Babylon. They got so used to it that they decided they're not going to return to Jerusalem. They stayed there. It's only a remnant, you know, only a remnant that went back to Jerusalem and rebuilt and reinstated the statehood of Israel and the services of the temple. Only a remnant. So likewise, we find that only a few people will make it to the heavenly Canaan, the heavenly city. Only a few. Why? Because some people will remain in this earth. They will remain comfortable. They will remain connected and associated with the lifestyle of this earth. They like the nice cities, the wardrobes, the fanciful cars and the fanciful houses, the music and the singing and the gaiety and all the other things that constituted the life of this world. They choose it. And unfortunately, even in the church, we find that there are some people who are bringing worldliness into the church because that's what they want. They will look for a church that suits them, that worship the way they want to worship. They want to listen to the particular preacher who will preach smooth things to them. We find that today. Because they don't want what God is saying is too much for them. They don't want to live their old lifestyle. They don't want to forsake that. They want to hold on to their own way of worshiping, their own way of serving God. Not the way God wants, their way. In other words, they're putting themselves above God. And that condition is viewed as a state of dry bones because they do not have spiritual life in them. And the only way that we could have spiritual life in us is for the Holy Spirit to resuscitate us. And for the Holy Spirit to resuscitate us, we must go through the process of repentance and humbling ourselves to God.
Was your question answered, Elder?
Well, my emphasis really is on the promise to Abraham's descendants during our time, because during our time they are like the sand of the sea, like the stars of heaven. And the promises were made clearly, not unconditionally, that I will take you, I will take you to your own land. So, of course, we know that.
Well, let me ask you, can God take them back to the land if they don't want to go?
No, he can't take them if they don't want to go, but there are many who will want to go. Don't you think that many would like to inherit the promised land? The bones were dug up of the chosen and taken there. As I said, Moses was
chosen. We're losing you, Elder. We're losing your voice. It's fading out.
Okay, I said.
Yes.
The importance that God stressed that, all through the Bible, you can see. He will take them back. Hosea.
I'm hearing some feedback. I'm hearing some feedback in your background, Elder. Remember, we're broadcasting live, so you got to make sure that your background is clear. So, I want to share with us, Elder, one of the most simple, or one of the simplest passage in the Bible. Yeah, go ahead.
Are you hearing me now?
Yes, yes.
Yes, so that's one thing. that's what I'm saying. That just go up in vapor. That's God's promise.
Okay.
I
appreciate that. I think your that question is answered. The answer for that question is provided in addition to what Dr. Laurencin have shared with us, which I totally agree with. But given a little bit more, I want to take you to one of the most familiar passage to, I think, all of us. It's John 3, verse 16. And I'm not even going to quote it, I'm going to read it. The Bible says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And there's two points I want to illustrate quickly in the interest of time. Number one, we need to take into consideration that all of us are created by God. And so we all belong to God by creation. Secondly, we need to also take into consideration that God's love is for all of us equally. When God called the Abraham and the children of Israel, the Bible oftentimes share with us that they were the least among the other nations. But God just want to use them to bless them and to also to bless the entire universe. So God always entrusted in all of us, all of humanity. And that's why what Pastor Laurencin in his answer said is so important, because one of the questions that he stated in his answer to you, that can God take them back if they don't want to go? And he made it clear that, I'm sorry, only a remnant did want to go back to reconstruct the wall. And so the message is very simple. The common thread of the message is so simple. And in conclusion, like last night I share that Jesus, our God, was the first and is and still is the first and last evangelist. When Adam sinned, God seek after Adam. Likewise, God is still seeking after all of us. So we have to look at God's plan that inclusive not just a particular group of people, but all of humanity. And all of us have the same opportunity to come to God. And if we accept him, then we will be blessed. And if we reject him, then we will be cursed. Back over to you, Dr. Laurencin, to give you the final thought.
Yes. God told the children of Israel when they left Egypt, "I will make you a kingdom of priests." The entire nation, not just the Levites, the entire nation was to become a kingdom of priests. Everyone a priest. And guess what? In the New Testament, we all are priests unto God. The Apostle Paul makes it abundantly clear. So a priest's job or work is to minister. We are all ministers, are we? We are ministering to the world. So we are priests. We are functioning as priests. Which offering did the priest offer in the Old Testament? The priest offered the offering of the lamb and the blood. Which offering are we ministering to the world today? The lamb, Jesus Christ, and his precious blood that was shed on Calvary. That's what we are ministering. So that's why God says in Revelation, we shall be priests unto God. In other words, we are ministering to the world, Jesus and his supreme sacrifice, the Savior of the world. Now, after people are saved, and are taken to heaven, the priestly work of God's people will not end. Why? Because now that we are saved, we are no longer going to call people to repentance, but we are calling on people to continue to worship God and to adore him, give him praise and adoration. This is why Revelation is filled with the refrain. The refrain is glory and honor and majesty to him that was, the one that is, who reigns forever and ever. Amen. So throughout eternity, we will be engaged in ministering to God. Hallelujah.
Praise God. So in other words, we'll be focusing on worshiping God.
Amen.
Which
Amen.
Is our solemn duty. And so thank you very much, Pastor. And it's a great way to end this segment, this show this evening. And so the underlying issue or the theme here is that you and I were created to worship God. And God is calling us back to do that which we were created to do, which is to worship God. And that's the reason why on this network, with our principle, our objectives are only two. First, to glorify God in line with worshiping God, in what Pastor I've just stated. And the second aspect of this show, second objective, is to encourage each other to worship God. And with that being said, I want to thank you, Dr. Laurencin, not just on behalf of the audience that are listening live here on various social media platforms, but I want to say thanks on behalf of heaven, our Commander-in-Chief, Jesus Christ himself, because you're carrying out the solemn duty that God has called you to do, is to play your priestly role by telling all of us and encouraging all of us that Jesus Christ, our ultimate high priest, is worthy of all of our praises. And so for this, I say thank you. With that being said, we want to take your prayer requests. Is there any prayer requests among us that you would like to make known at this time? For me, Pastor, since you lost, we're on the show. I have lost my uncle that you prayed for last week. And so as a family, we're in the process of preparing to bury my uncle. Also, one of my uncle is here, Uncle Clifton, and I just want to acknowledge my uncle as well, as we in the process of preparing to bury his brother, my uncle, Uncle Henry. But we're not mourning as those who have no hope, because we know that our Redeemer lives. And also, Elder William just mentioned someone that in the church family just passed away. And so there are many among us as our faces differ, so are our various needs and wants. And so I am asking you to pray a prayer of comfort, a prayer of reminding us that we are pilgrims, we're just passing through. And maybe perhaps someone may have a prayer request that they want to make known at this time. Anyone? Anyone else?
My friend Chica's dad is not well. And so pray for his health.
Praise God. So this is the Martin. Now we can hear you.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay. What's his name?
I don't even know his name, but her name is Chica.
Okay. Anyone else?
Her dad.
Thank you. Anyone else? Well, with that being said, Pastor, if you could just pray for us. And also, as we are finalizing the broadcasting and the launching of network, we have some aspect of it that is working right now. But tomorrow, there are other aspects of it that needs to fully launch. And so we just pray that everything will grow smoothly in respect to that tomorrow as well, please.
The Apostle Paul says, "For this reason I bow my knees unto the Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the family of heaven and earth is named, So, Lord God, we bow before you with humble hearts this evening, presenting to you the prayer request. Our hearts are saddened to know that even our brothers and sisters, our loved ones we prayed for, are now sleeping in Jesus. You know best, oh God. When we pray for healing, when we pray for restoration, we do not know how and in what form you will answer. But we trust you, O Lord God. We trust you. We believe in you. And we know that you will provide the comfort that is needed during such time of mourning. So on behalf of Pastor Barnaby and his family, we pray that you surround them with your arms of comfort and love. May your Holy Spirit breathe the peace of God into their hearts as they cry, as they moan. We thank you for Sister Motley's request on behalf of her friend Tika's dad, who needs special prayer. We know that you know his name, you know his condition better than any human being, better than any doctor or nurse or medical practitioner. You understand our frame. You know the cause for our discomfort, the pain that we feel in our bodies, whether it be a brain condition, whether it be functionality of the eyes and vision problem, whether it be respiratory or the regulation of the heart, the level of our temperature, or the condition of our inner organs, all that you have created, you know how to regulate it, how to make it function at its optimum level. So we pray, Father, for those who are having brain aneurysm, we pray that you bring healing to their minds, those who are having dementia, those who are going through Alzheimer's disease, those who are going through, who are experiencing glaucoma or vision problems, those who are having upper respiratory problems, hearing, they need hearing aid, they can't hear properly. Those, oh Father, who are having breathing problems, asthmatic conditions, oh Father, of the lungs, conditions, oh Father, of the heart, hypertension, those who have had bypass surgery, whose ventricular system is not functioning well, there's blockage of the arteries that is causing stroke, that is causing different conditions of well-being in terms of the feeding, the diet conditions that are impacting our health. All of these, Father, women who are suffering with tumors in their lymph nodes, and men who are having prostate problems, and women who are having breast lumps in the breast, and other conditions, oh Father, that are affecting the back problems, like back spasm and the pain in the liver and the pancreatic conditions, and the conditions of gallbladder and conditions of the intestines, and those who are having constipation and problems and issues dealing with the digestive tract. Lord God, all of those different diseases and conditions that are affecting, bringing pain and discomfort, in the name of Jesus, we pray that you'll come against it. We pray that you'll rebuke it. We pray that you'll speak health and healing to each of us tonight, this evening, through the precious promises of Jesus Christ, in the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. We confess the name of Jesus. We bow at the feet of Jesus tonight. Take us and make us yours. Consecrate us, purify us, Lord God, and remove all the maladies from us and cleanse us, because Psalm 103 verse 1 and 1, 2 and 3 says, who is a God like unto thee that healeth all our diseases? Father, we give you praise and glory for what you have done and what you will do for us by faith. We know that with God, all things are possible. So remember me, O God, remember what I need, not what I want, but what I need in my life so that I could be a more effective vessel to serve you and to proclaim the everlasting gospel of the kingdom. Same, Father, for Pastor Barnaby, same for Sister Markley, same for Brother Marcel and the other people who have been contributing to this ministry. Bless each one, bless each family that is represented here this evening. And I ask for the listening audience, for those who are listening right now, even to this prayer, as I pray, that the Holy Spirit will touch their lives, particularly those who have not yet surrendered to you, that they will come to realize that your word is indeed inspired. Your word is indeed reliable. Your word is indeed authoritative. Your word is indeed the lamp unto our feet and the light unto our path. That they will accept you. They will surrender to you. They will go all the way with you so that you will take us to heaven with you when you come the second time to live and reign with you as priests and kings forever and ever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Again, my pastor and my friend, on behalf of all of us near and far, we want to thank you for blessing us in such a marked way. And for the wider audience, we want to thank you. This show will not be the same without you. We will not be the same without you. And truly, we want to thank you for spending your time with us over the months. And as we're in the process of transition into another phase of this ministry, we're asking you to continue to walk with us. By you joining us, you let our burden much lighter. Clearly, the Bible makes note of this because it was important to teach us this lesson. When Moses was leading the children of Israel and they were fighting, your time when Moses and will get tired, and Joshua and others will, and Aaron will hold up his hand. And when he hold up his hand, then he will have great success. And so likewise, we cannot do this alone. We need your help. The preaching of the gospel require all hands on deck, all of God's children to work to accomplish the great task, which is to lead men, women, boys and girls back to Jesus Christ. Jesus, through His Spirit, is calling us to Himself. So help us as we continue to work to build up the kingdom of God. Tomorrow, I want to invite all of you to join us tomorrow. And after tomorrow's show, we are going to be able to watch the various shows on the various network. We are going to regroup after tomorrow. But tomorrow I give you more detail on how you can watch the shows on the various platforms. You're going to be able to watch it first on Chromecast, Google Play, Windows, Android TV, Roku TV, Fire TV, Apple TV, Chugo TV, Glory Star Satellite, and also Glory Star Satellite is inclusive of Channel 33, which I will share with you. Those in North America will be able to go directly to Channel 33. But I will give you more detail tomorrow, and so you have this information. Please share the news with your friends, your family, your friends, your family members, members of your family, your friend, your co-worker, etc. And so we all can join hand in doing our part. As you know, when you broadcast the message on these various platforms, it will require money as well. But we trust God, because God says everything in this world belongs to Him. Everything belongs to Him. So as such, we trust Him with our future, because we saw how He led us in the past. We see what He's doing for us now. So we have no reason to doubt the future. We will trust God to carry us through. Again, thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for serving my God. Thank you for serving our God, Jesus Christ, the risen Savior. God bless you. Good night. And I'm asking you please to join us tomorrow for this.